Have I not commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. Men of Valor and Evangelism. No Man Left Behind, Part 2.
And I need you. As the men are coming in to find their seats, I'll just do a brief introduction. My name is Michael Dantzie, and currently I'm a member of the Great Brooklyn Seventh-day Adventist Church. I'm originally from London, and now I live in Wolverhampton. It's a privilege. It's a privilege for me to be here with you all. It's a privilege for me to share the word, because I don't stand up here having a right to preach the word. It's a privilege. Amen. I hope you understand what I'm saying. It's not a right. I didn't earn this, and I never will earn this. It's a privilege and an honor for me to do what I'm doing. The reason why I stand up here is because I know what Jesus' love can do for my life, and I know what it can do for the lives of anybody who's willing to receive it. Amen. We've just saying that. I'm going to start with a word of prayer. I'm going to choose to kneel, but you can bow your heads with me. My Father, which is in heaven, according to the promise that you gave me in Luke 11, verse 13, that if I ask for the Holy Spirit, he'll be given to me. So, Father, give me your Holy Spirit. As I speak, it's not my words, and it's definitely not my power. For, Father, the power to save lies with you. The power to change lies with you. The power to give life where there's death lies with you. And the power to convince and bring, especially our young men among us, to you, as Patrick so wonderfully sung, when I surrender, Lord, when I surrender. So, Father, speak now, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have your Bibles with you, I would like you to turn to the book of 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. I've decided to entitle my section, Remember. Remember. One simple word, remember. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. And we're reading from verse 1, but my focus is going to be verse 3 and 4. The title of my mini sermonette is Remember. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 1 to 4. My focus is verse 3 and 4. I'm reading from the Authorized Version, but you can follow along in any version that you have. The Bible says this: Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, with all the saints which are in all Achaia. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of what? All comfort. Verse 4. Who comforteth us in all our what? Tribulation, that we may be able to what? Comfort them which are in what? Any trouble by the what? Comfort wherewith we ourselves are what? Comforted of God. Now, men, I would like you to respond when I ask a question. If you don't know the answer, that's fine. But if you think you know the answer, please respond. I'm going to go to the text and I'm going to ask you a question according to the text. And I want the answer from the text. Are we clear? All right. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Look at verse 3. Number 1, what are some of the names it gives God in verse 3? Look at verse 3 very carefully. What name does it give God? God of Father of mercies. What else? God of all comfort. That's what I want to focus on. Number one, God is the God of what? All what? Comfort. Verse 4. The Bible says, who comforteth us in all our what? So according to the Bible, is there a trial? Is there a tribulation? Is there a situation that God cannot comfort you in? No. Question number 3. Now think very carefully, the answers in the text. Why does God seek to comfort an individual? Only one man? The brother's right? I want all of us to get it. We have to all get it. The answer's in the text. I'm going somewhere. Before I preach what's on my heart, we first have to see what the Bible is saying. Are we clear, brothers? I was going to say brothers and sisters. Brothers. So used to speaking to a mixed multitude. Look at the text again. Why does God comfort us in our trouble? What's the reason? What is the purpose? Yes, but what does the text say? So that we can comfort anyone in any, listen, look at the text, in any trouble. Now let's break that down, brothers. The title of my sermon is called Remember. 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 Let's get the idea, or one of the ideas in this text, because there are many ideas we can get, but let's get one of the most powerful ideas I hope will inspire you to action. The Bible says that the reason why God comforted you, the reason why God comforted you in your mess, in your trouble, by implication, the reason why there's comfort, there must have been what? Distress. You can't comfort someone who's already comfortable. Let me give you a simple illustration. Some of you have nice mattresses at home. Mine is getting on my nerves. Me and my wife are saying we need to buy that expensive mattress online. Never have I appreciated a mattress until I had a rubbish mattress. Now imagine, as you sit on your nice expensive mattress, it's comfortable, and I come to you and I say, here's a better one. It's going to be very hard to convince you that the mattress that I'm introducing is better than the one that you have if it's comfortable. For there to be comfort, for God to comfort you, by implication, that means prior to the comfort, you was in distress, there was some trouble, there was something troubling you. Is that clear? Is that logical? Right. But the idea I want to focus on is the reason God wants to comfort you. God is so unselfish, the Bible says in 1 John 4 verse 8, that God is what? Love. God is so unselfish, this is why I love God. He's so unselfish that in his purpose of allowing you to go through your tribulation, to go through your mess and your distress, but not to leave you there, to comfort you, there was a purpose and a design. He was seeing every single, and here is where we get specific to why we are here as men. He was planning how you as a man, did you hear what I said? Not as a human being or as an individual, you as a man will be able to comfort another man or young boy. Don't get me wrong, and don't put God in a box with my statement. If there is a woman filled with the Spirit of God, with experience with the love of God and his power and what he can do, and it's only a young lady, a young woman, God will use that young woman to comfort another man. But let me tell you something. When there's another man who can resonate and relate with the exact same feelings and emotions that only a man can feel, approaches another young man and says, I've been where you've been. That is far more significant and far more powerful than anybody else speaking to that young man. But brothers, here is where the tires meet the road. Fathers, uncles, granddads, fathers, let me speak to you for a moment. When is the last time you sat your son down and told them your story? When? You are doing them a disservice if you haven't told them why you are so hard the way that you are. Think about it. It would make no sense. Imagine a military father training his son every single day. Son, press ups. Son, come on, you got to eat a certain way. You got to eat clean. Son, you know what? Sleep with a gun underneath your bed. Son, come on, 5 mile run every single day. But dad, we're not in war. But dad, why are you so strict on me? We're not in war. And the father never, ever explains to the son, we are in a war. The preparation will make no sense. Are you following me? Fathers, some of you are strict. Son, worship. Daughter, worship. You're going to study your Bible and you've never told him why you're so serious. You've never told him why you have the scars, not on externally, but in your heart. You've never sat him down and explained to him the comfort that God gave you. And now you are the way that you are because you were comforted by God, by his comfort. You are doing him, your family, a disservice. Fact. You wonder why he's rebelling? You wonder why he don't understand you? You wonder why he won't obey your laws? Sit him down. By the grace of God, I'm imploring you. This is a call to action. This is an appeal. Sit him down and be real with him. For the first time maybe in your life that you've ever done. We as from African descendants and Caribbean descendants, you're going to need God to do this. Because it's not in our nature to be open. It's not in our nature to cry. It's not in our nature to hug. And maybe men of other cultures, I don't know how it is, so I can only speak from my background. It's not in our nature to give our other young boys a hug, even though they are flesh and blood. Is this what Jesus would be like? No, but don't get me wrong. That doesn't mean you ain't got the Holy Ghost. That means you have to allow the love of God to take you deeper. Are you hearing me? One last point. The text says, who comforteth us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble. Brothers, most of us, maybe all of us, I don't know, we don't believe that. Let me illustrate. Michael, man, them young boys there in church, I don't know how to reach them, man. Some of them in the road life, some of them in gangs. I've never done those things. I don't know how to relate to them. In our innocency or our sincerity, we've said some of these things. And so in saying those things, we take a step back and we hold our hands up and say, Lord, how do I get through to these young men? Because I haven't gone down his road. Brothers, the Bible says you don't have to have gone down his road. God says you don't have to have gone down his road. God says, have you been in trouble? And has God comforted you? So remember tears that you cried. What, you're too weak, you're too big, huh? Jesus wept. Who is bigger and badder than God? And Jesus found himself weeping. Found himself crying tears. Found himself crying tears. Found himself allowing a child to sit on his knee. Brothers, remember. Stop shutting up those feelings and emotions. Remember the trouble you was in. But don't stop there. Remember how God comforted you. Brothers, there's an implication in this verse that is powerful. The Bible calls the Holy Ghost the what? Oh, my days. I'm getting excited now. The Bible calls the Holy Ghost the what? Could it be? Maybe why you haven't experienced more power in your life, the Holy Spirit is called the what? And the Bible says God will comfort you. Maybe you are shutting your heart to the Spirit by not allowing yourself to cry. Oh, we didn't see that coming, did we? God became a man so he can feel. Did we catch it? God became a man so he can feel. And our culture has prevented us from feeling. That's why even some of you now are saying, why is he screaming? Because I'm passionate. You like to scream at dominoes, don't you? Yeah, man, six. We can scream then. Some of you are too young to know about Brian Lara. Yeah. Clive said I was getting a bit old. Brothers, I'm here to encourage. Let me close with a transparent testimony. Is that all right? You sure? It's not going to be discussed in the board later on, no? GBK elders? It's all in the water, amen? In the depths of the sea. The Bible says in Romans 1:16, for I'm not ashamed of what? The gospel of Christ. The gospel is designed to save sinners. So in me declaring in what I was saved from, I can't be ashamed, amen? So I have to be transparent, my brothers, because I don't want to give you the idea that I'm just speaking theory. I just woke up one day, I'm going to expound this verse and sit down. No. Many years ago, I can't remember how long it was, I came to a place where my debts, my work struggles, my expectations of myself as a man got the better of me. I know some of you know what I'm talking about. I have a beautiful wife. I have three children. And now I'm in a situation now where I'm trying my best, but my best doesn't seem to be good enough. You know, we talk about mentoring our young men and mentoring them to be Christians. But brothers, there's a place to mentor them on how to make money. Now you said amen. I'm telling you it's needed. If you want to get married, what do you think you need to do? Guess what? It's not easy if you don't know how. If you know how, it's easy. But most of us get in that situation, we don't know what to do with ourselves. And I got to the place where I allowed the tribulations and the struggles to get my mind to a place where I was feeling less of a man. Stressed. Even though I was preaching and praying for everybody else, this one thing in my heart just couldn't seem to get away from me. I would pray, ask God to help. And then it would seem, it was like a friend you don't like to, you know how those people who come to your house, you don't want them to come to your house? It was like that. One of those stupid flies you come into your house in the summer. You don't want the fly in your house. It would go and it would come back. I would pray and then I'd be sitting in my room and these overwhelming thoughts would come over my mind. Look at you. Look at the stupid mistakes you've made, financial mistakes you've made. Look at this failed venture. Look at you. And you call yourself a man? I phoned my brother up in despair. And when I say despair, I am not using that word lightly. So much despair, I couldn't even pray. Are you hearing me? Tears running down my eyes. I'm being real like this because I know someone needs to hear that God can give comfort in any trouble. And when he gives that comfort, I can't do him and you a disservice by not testifying of the power that comes upon you when you surrender to God. I called Jonathan in despair, tears running down my eyes. I said, Jonathan, I don't believe that God will forgive me. He said, Michael, shh. Don't say those things. Words have power. He said, say this, Jesus loves you. Just keep saying those words, John, Mike. Jonathan said, Mike, just keep saying those words. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. And here's the part of my story. He lives in Leicester. I live in Wolverhampton. It's an hour's drive. It was 3 a.m. Guess what he did next? He didn't put down the phone and say, I'm going to continue praying for you. He says, I'm coming. Is someone hearing me today? I'm coming. Some of us right now are missing out on glorious opportunities by not helping the closest brother that's arms reach away. Forget trying to jump on a plane. What about your sons and your daughters and the boys in your church? All they want from you is to be real. My brother said, Mike, I'm coming. He drove all the way from Leicester to my house and prayed down the Holy Ghost that wiped away all tears from my eyes. I couldn't even speak God's name because the tears were too deep. Does somebody understand what I'm talking about? Does somebody understand the text when the Bible says he hides our tears in a bottle? Does somebody understand that you don't have to speak a prayer? God can read your heart. Does somebody understand what I'm talking about, what the Word of God is talking about, that God will comfort you in any trouble? My brother drove to my house and prayed with me at 3 a.m, and I got the victory by the grace of God. Men, do not leave this place not feeling a burden for somebody. Do not leave this place. Somebody is on your heart. God is faithful, because we were not designed, you were not called to be comforted by yourself. God has a design and a purpose for every single one of us. I don't care where you're from. I don't care what sin you are even now. God can change it around by the end of this day. Even now. Satan is a liar. And some of us, I pray we don't fight the Spirit of God. If you are moved today to an emotional response, if you are moved today to weep, let yourself weep and let it go and let the glory and the power of God fall upon you, because God wants to take away that pain. Amen? I don't care what it is. Don't let Satan stop you from receiving the healing that you deserve in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. 38 seconds to low. For 8 seconds to go. Praise God, I'm never on time. I'm going to pray as I close. I have to pray. I can't preach like this and not pray, because that's where the power is. Amen. I'm going to call you to the front, seats and whatever. You know, it's not practical. But if you want to pray with me in your heart and your minds for that comfort that you need, for a tribulation, for a trial, for a sin, for a burden, for a regret, whatever it is, I hope you feel your need. Because God wants to give you comfort right now, today. Comfort from sin, comfort from burdens, whatever it is, my brothers. I pray as I pray, you pray for yourself, for that power to come upon you right now. Amen? Amen. Let us pray, let us pray. Father in heaven, you have been so gracious unto us. We plead for your comfort. We plead for your comfort. I know there are men who, like me, have fallen into that situation of regret, of low self-worth, taking their eyes off your strength. And although it was my fault, thank God there is no condemnation. Thank God you're more concerned about the remedy than how I got into that mess. Thank God you were more concerned, Father, with me than me letting you down. Thank God, Father, you are concerned with the remedy. And we've read from your word, you are the God of all comfort, who can comfort us in any tribulation, so that we can be prepared, so that we can be equipped to comfort anybody else in any trouble. I pray, as I'm praying, hearts will be lifted up to you. We'll be real with you to say, Lord, for that situation, I need your Spirit. I need your comfort. I've regretted. I've sinned. I've been burdened with guilt. But Father, as your word says, you will comfort me. And that comfort is the Spirit of God entering into our hearts, taking away the pain, taking away the regret, and replacing it with the joy of the Lord. Thank you, Father, for hearing and answering our prayer in Jesus' name.
Men of Valor and Evangelism. Have I not commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest.